So my topic is on the operation theater protocols during the COVID-19 pandemic. And now since we are still in the lockdown period, so now the protocols are changing day by day. So what I would like to start off by saying is this COVID-19 pandemic has really caught us unawares. And what we really have to remember is this virus is from all the information that we are getting. You can hear me? Yeah. Like from all the information, it looks like this virus is going to be with us for quite some time. You know, at least for the next 6 months or even a year. So this topic is the protocols which we have put together for the operation theater in the ophthalmology setup is like at least targeting for the next 6 months to at least a year. And although this infection is a problem for everybody, there's particular concern for the ophthalmologist and also the ENT surgeons and other close risk healthcare workers because of the increased risk, because of the close proximity to the patient. Now, this is what is making everybody so concerned. Can I start my theater? What and all precautions should be taken? Right at the beginning, I would like to start with a disclaimer. I think most of the speakers in every webinar really says this. Since guidelines are evolving every day in the management of these patients, so whatever we might be talking today may not be applicable in the next few days. So it's very, very important that all of us are tuned to what is changing every day. And this slide, I just put the pictures of how the virus is to just remind us what is this invisible enemy we are all fighting against. So as a way of introduction, I would like to state that the goal of all protocols, so what is the purpose of putting all these protocols? So it's very, very important, whatever we are putting is keeping the safety of the staff and patients during keeping them safe during the stay in the hospital and also during any procedures. So this is really important. So all of us are very anxious that our hospital should not become a hotspot or a containment area. Then the implications are so much when the whole hospital is quarantined, staff are quarantined. So to avoid all that, it's very important we keep this in mind. And as of now, as we all understand, currently majority of the hospitals are right now operating only on emergency cases. But then as the lockdown is, we are slowly inching towards lifting of the lockdown. I think most of the hospitals are very cautiously planning on restarting elective surgeries. So that's when all these questions are coming. So when we start routine surgeries, like what is it do we have to keep in mind? And then some hospitals might be more at zone, so they might have more at-risk patients. So do they have to take any additional protocols? And the general principles of all these protocols, what we have to remember is as of now, since all of us are aware, there is no treatment for this virus and the only way is prevention. And social distancing has been so strongly emphasized, hand hygiene. And suspect all our COVID carriers and follow standard precautions, which I will be explaining soon. So the topics which I'm going to be covering in this talk is a little bit about the preoperative patients protocol. Now here I've not put very much in detail all these protocols. So this is the most important area, but I've kept it purposely brief because as of now, there's still the guidelines are not clear. So there is no rationale in some of the things we do. So I didn't want to dwell too much into that. And also generally itself, the talk is a little small. So we've got a lot of time for a discussion and a lot of time for our question and answers. Then the personal protective equipment, I believe last week we had a very detailed webinar on this. And also the document has also been sent. What is it? Who has to wear what? How do we dispose it? How do we disinfect and all those questions. Then a little bit on the specific protocols during this COVID pandemic, what is to be followed. And then all the other things pertaining to the OT, like the air conditioning systems, water system, autoclave, instrument cleaning, sterilization, the documentation part, staff training, orientation and auditing. So these are the topics which I'll be covering. So the specific preoperative patient protocol, which we have started, which every organization is also asking us to do, is we were never doing this before. So now we are eliciting a history of fever for the patient, history of travel, area of origin. So all this is documented, then it could serve as a reference later on. Suppose any patient develops a problem later, then at least we'll have some idea of when he came to us, what was his condition. And then now there's a special consent form. I'm sure all hospitals are aware of this. The IMA is also asking us to get this special consent form, which states that the healthcare system is not to be blamed for anything which happens. And then patients are now wearing the mask. So this was something which obviously they were not doing earlier. So that's one extra thing we've started doing. And then made aware of hand hygiene. So as much as possible, wherever possible, patients washing their hand with sanitizer, soap and water. Now, this is going to be the most debatable sentence, I think. What and all are the extra tests that are need to be done during the COVID pandemic? So this is the question I'm sure most are having. There is no clarity at all. So whether COVID testing need done for every contaminant area, red zone area, do we have to do the COVID test? So as of now, as I said, there is no guideline. There is no need to do COVID testing. Suppose in case the patient is highly suspect, patient, it can be affordable and it is being done in the place where you're from. So from what I hear, the test is around 4,500. And if it is possible, it can be done. But there's no need for a mandatory testing for every patient. So here at Aravind, they're not doing. These are the things that are doing now. The chest x-ray and monitoring oxygen saturation. Again, all these things, I'm not saying that this is the thing to do. Logic of doing this is at least we'll have some documentation on what the patient's condition was when we were treating him. So that's what we are doing. And it's monitoring the oxygen saturation. Again, the silent hypoxia is now that. So we are doing the pulse oximeter in the theater and at least two times before in the block room also. This literature which I have quoted here from the IJO in April 2020. So that's the latest consensus statement on the preferred practice during COVID-19 pandemic. And people who have not read it, it's a very nice article which is put together. All the consensus from the more than about 20 institutes across India. So that gives a guideline for each and every part of our hospital, OPD, ward, everything it gives. The instruments, what investigations to be done. So that's a very good document to read. So the preoperative other protocols which can be remembered to be followed is as far as possible surgeries can be done as daycare. So avoiding ward admission, hospital admission. So less patients being in close contact. And the systemic conditions to be evaluated thoroughly by a physician. And to confirm all preoperative investigations before starting the surgery. And from one doctor who I was discussing with, they do this investigations like about 14 days prior. So they say if you defer the surgery at least for 2 weeks, then it could be like indirectly the patient has been quarantined. So you're very confirmed that the patient does not have any symptom. So that's one approach some institutes are taking. You know, you do the investigations, everything, keep it ready and tell the patients to come back after 2 weeks. And whether all supplies are available before starting surgery. And then to always choose the quickest and safest possible procedure. So that everybody is spending less time in the block room and in the operation theater. So before I go on to the actual protocols inside the operation theater, it is nice to remember what is this universal precautions. So these 5 points are something which it's very important that all of us keep on remembering this. The most important is the education and awareness, since this is something so new. And although as doctors and other, we might be aware and reading the literature and getting all these information, the rest of our staff may not be aware of this. So, and once they become aware, then it's easier to make. So education and awareness of staff, hand hygiene, that is washing and sanitizing, personal protective equipment, who should wear, what should be worn, cleaning of all surfaces, As we know, this virus particles have been studied to remain in the atmosphere for like for different surfaces, different timings, 24 hours on viable surfaces, 72 hours on innate surfaces. So the only method of we can do to get rid of it and safe disposal of waste. So these are the five principles of universal precaution. Now, personal protective equipment, I don't want to talk too much about it, only to say ophthalmologists are this is definitely a person specific, and if you are very specific about something, you can very well go ahead and wear it. But as a general guideline, it's I think everybody has agreed that as ophthalmologists, there's no need for us to put any extra suit, that other containment suit. So gloves is known. The gown is, again, there are so many discussions about the type of gowns to be worn. So now, depending on the masks and respirators, so respirators is what is recommended. And again, I think last week's talk, this was covered on how to reuse them, how to decontaminate them, since some cost is also involved in this. And goggles and face shields are practical during the surgery. So it's more for the anesthetist. Even the Anesthetist Association also has a little bit brought down their recommendation for all these things. Now, coming to the protocols for restarting the OT. So assuming when the OT was decommissioned, so maybe some hospitals may not have been using the operation theater in the last 45 days nearly. So right from April, we shut down. Or maybe some hospitals are still operating emergency cases. But whatever is the situation, so suppose if after May 18th, the lockdown is lifted and all the restrictions are less, then maybe if everybody is geared to start doing theater, so maybe next week is the correct time to start doing all these procedures. So first thing is complete cleaning of the operation theater. And I'm sure all the staff who are already working in the theater know this protocol of, so I'm not going to every step of cleaning. And the air conditioning units, if they have been shut down, at least 2 or 3 days have to be run. And if there is an air handling unit and HEPA filter, so that can also be run. And fumigation, if an air handling unit is not available, then fumigation is a good idea to fumigate with whatever you want, either formalin or bacillocid or any other. Because this theater has been closed for so many days. And to check the RO system, the autoclaves, to do a culture, and take an inventory and supplies to be checked. So this is the checklist kind of thing for before starting the operation theater. Now, once you start, what we have changed from what we were not doing previously is now we are emphasizing more on the cleaning. So protocols during the surgery, furniture and instruments, now we are recommending to clean after every surgery. And how to clean it, who should be cleaning, all those SOPs should be written by the individual institutes. And the used instruments, biomedical waste, should be moved immediately and not kept for any period of time inside the operation theater. And the surgical team needs to re-scrub and change all their gown and gloves for every case. And any procedure which generates aerosol. So I think every specialty is now coming up with their own guidelines, retina, orbit, like use of cautery, use of suction. So they have alternative methods to do all that. So be very careful of any procedure that's going to generate aerosol generating. So now a gap of at least 15 to 20 minutes to be kept before starting the next surgery. So this is necessary because now if you're going to say that all equipments, instruments, furniture should be clean, you need at least this 15 minutes. And then also this 15 minute gap is good for, for more air circulation and more ventilation to happen. But again, this might again change. Right now, this is the maybe in June, July, this might change. And only one case to be operated per theater. Avoid sharing consumables as minimum staff inside the OT. Now, this is the most debated topic here when you talk about operation theaters, about the air conditioning. So actually, there was a very nice webinar on Wednesday conducted by All India Institute, which had very eminent speakers from across India. So there was Dr. Nirmal Frederick from Chennai, who had a full 20 minutes, half an hour talk only. So people who are more interested in this topic can please go and listen to that webinar. It was very, very exhaustive. And he had referred so many sources to the type of air conditioning. But in the end of his talk, what was the conclusion was, it's a very simple this thing. He says, what he says is, at least for the next 3 months, don't change anything. So as of now, you just continue with whatever air conditioning systems you have and don't go about changing, because all this is going to have a lot of structural changes and a lot of cost implications also. Because what people are, I think the negative pressure means the air inside the operation theater is pushed outside. Assuming that the air inside is contaminated with all the patient's breath and everything, so we don't want that air to be circulating anymore. But actually, this negative pressure is needed only when areas where you're treating a COVID-positive patient. Suppose if you're operating on a COVID-positive patient or in an ICU where you're treating COVID-positive patients. So that is the place where a negative pressure ventilation is definitely needed. So for us, when we are assuming that we're all going to be treating COVID negative patients, although some might be asymptomatic, that's a different thing. So as of now, we can still continue with what we're having. If you have an air handling unit with HEPA filters, that reduces contamination. And one recommendation is to increase the airflow from whatever it is currently now. So I think currently people do 2 to 20 or something. They're asking us to increase to even 30 airflow per minute. Positive pressure can still be maintained. And then to regularly check the temperature and humidity, as we always do. So one thing which came out from the webinar is, suppose if you want to have at least little bit of negative pressure, they said a 10 degree differential between the atmospheric, the outside temperature and your operation theater temperature. That would give you at least little bit of negative pressure. So that's about the air conditioning unit. Now, coming to the handling of the reverse osmosis water plant. So again, water is so important and we use it in so many of our critical stages in our theater, instrument washing and autoclave and other things. So we are assuming the decommissioning of the water plant should have been planned before. So I'm assuming every hospital should have taken care of this, cleaned the tank and make sure it was dry. So once we have it, then this back flush of the regularly, change the filters if water quality is not good, ensure water is not stored for more than 48 hours, and tubings to be flushed with a diluted sodium hypochlorite if needed, and the water must be tested for the microbial load and chemical analysis. The autoclaves per se, again, this must have been routinely being used. Suppose in case it wasn't in use and it was shut down, then the water was completely drained and the autoclave should have been totally dry. And when you're planning to restart it, so make sure that all these things which are associated with autoclave are checked properly, the electrical cables, printer, all the other pressure gauges, all the other and electronic items. And then we can run the autoclave at least once in an empty load with all the Bovidic indicators and all the other indicators and make sure that they are color change and must be found satisfactory. So that's very important. And maybe if a senior staff ensures this, it will be much more reassuring that all the autoclave is functioning properly. Now, all the other equipments inside the OT, there is nothing specific we have to do because of this COVID prevention. These and all are the general maintenance is more than enough. So again, there was some debate whether phaco machine is a source of infection. Does it, this thing with aerosol, the vitrectomy machines. But again, all this is not so much of a problem. So this routine maintenance and cleaning of these machines is sufficient. Now, surgical instruments. So even if the instruments have been autoclaved and stored, since a long period has elapsed from that time, it is much better if everything is again reopened, washed once again, and re-autoclaved. So that's very important that we don't use any stored instruments, assuming they would still be sterile. Now, this is a very, very important issue to be checked into. Since nearly for 1.5 months have gone, so many items would have expired. So this is one problem all of us are definitely facing. So we are losing a lot of this because of the expiry. So make sure all the consumables you're going to use have been stored properly in all these days. The sterility and packing of items have to be checked, and especially the expiry of the items. So it's very, very important, even before you start cleaning itself, I would think that checking the storage cupboard is the most important consumables. Because even the staff also were not coming regularly. So then staff are working in shifts. So we find that is a little bit of this thing here. When the shift changes, so it's a little bit of communication problem and you tend to miss out on all this. Then the OT cleaning protocol, regular cleaning. There's nothing extra special for this. And clean all furniture on a daily basis and also in between the surgeries. And in OTs without AHU, surface cleaning and fumigation can be done. Now, disinfectant recommended. So generally, as you all are aware, we actually don't use much disinfectant inside the theater for maybe mopping the floor. So now, since we are saying that we have to clean all the furniture, clean all the instruments, so what is recommended, which is really effective against this virus, is any of these agents, 1% sodium hypochlorite, 1% Lysol, and 70% isopropyl alcohol. So depending on the item to be cleaned, whether you want to disinfect your instruments, that really has to, because then we don't want landing up into another problem like TAS or something. So if you soak your instruments in any of these disinfectants not done properly, then that could also become a problem. So this instrument disinfectant is again up to the individual hospitals to decide on, but generally these disinfectants are very potent. But the dilution should be really carefully looked into, whether it's being diluted properly, stored properly. Biomedical waste management, again, the same principles are still maintaining. Nothing has been changed in that. So whatever has to go into the yellow bin, red bin, blue bin, and then disposed of as per the protocol. Only thing is, dispose it as more quickly as possible, instead of keeping it stored in the premises like before. And then finally, before restarting the OT, this is a very, very important thing to do. I think most open and it's available for taking culture. So culture of air by air exposure or swab method, water culture, and at least wait for a 24-hour culture results before restarting the OT. As I was mentioning earlier, the staff training, adherence to established protocols, documentation, auditing these documents are really important. And this should be really, and emphasis cannot be a strong emphasis. So to conclude, just to put everything together, the preoperative screening of patients, staff adherence to the recommended PPEs, and to all other protocols, close monitoring of patients postoperatively also, and routine OT protocols to be followed. And most important is there is unnecessary panic among the staff also and the patients. So it's up to the senior doctors or the senior management to really keep on reassuring the patients that everything has been adequately adhered to and our hospital is really safe for them to be treated. So that's a very important message to be taken. Thank you.
So one of the questions, sir, is how to clean the FACO hand? It's a very specific question.
No. Dr. Chandrasekhar, you want to take that question?
Yes, madam. So actually today we had a meeting in AOS regarding guidelines for cataract and FACO. So they were talking about FACO being aerosol or not aerosol. As of now, there is no evidence to say there is any infection that can come from FACO. So FACO is permitted. So they were talking about two handpieces and one handpiece. So majority of the small hospitals do not have two handpieces. If you have two hand pieces, you can use alternatively, but the tip and the cap, the sleeve should be autoclaved for every patient. That is, if we should have at least 2-3 sets for that. So that is the answer that they've given. That will be the ideal recommendation also. Okay, madam?
Okay, sir.
So there are a few questions about the before surgery. So one question is, should COVID testing be done for GA patients, because the aerosol generation is more for these patients?
Right now, there is no mandatory rule or any regulation that COVID test has to be done for the surgery patients. But if you are going to take up a GA case, your anesthetist can see and they will definitely ask for an X-ray. All those recommendations, but we cannot force a COVID test for any purpose at this point. And this may also go according to the law in the each state, because Delhi they are able to do. outside in labs for COVID tests. And one thing we must all have in mind is doing a COVID test is good. Right now, we don't have antibody tests, so only the PCR test. So PCR positive means you have to be 100% careful and better not do the case. You wait for a period where it can be postponed. But PCR is negative, it doesn't 100% mean that they are not infected. So we have to assume all cases are positive and go ahead. But if you definitely know it's a positive case, better to postpone. Madam, anything you want to add, madam?
No, sir, I think that answers it. Yeah, so because it's not available and it's not mandatory also. And the anesthetist, they are taking additional. So the anesthetists are wearing the face shield and they have a hood, they have a plastic hood with the way they put their hands in and do the intubation.
So if GA has to be done, okay, man, there are a few points we should note. So the GA team will be very small, one or two people will be there, and the surgical team will have to wait outside when intubation is being done. So during intubation process, the GA team should have maximum protection. And the hood has to be used for intubation and extubation. During this process, surgical team should not be inside. And once the hood is removed, we need to give sufficient time. Because if at all there had been any droplets or something, it is likely to be inside the hood. So the circulation of air should be allowed and some time. And then only the surgical team will come in. Once the surgery is over, they have to go out. And only then the extubation has to be done. This is a basic principle for GA.
Yes, yes, that's excellent, sir. That is a good point. Thank you. What is FMS? So there's another question. Is there a need to change FMS in each case as it could be a costly business? Aware of what is FMS?
I don't understand.
PPE only is there. I think facial mask. No, but if they mean mask, there is no need to change mask between every case. What is recommended to be changed between every case is only the gloves and your surgical gown only.
Actually, so if ideal, yes, madam. Ideally,
yes, yes, you the mask, can supplement,
yes, madam. Ideally, when they wear a mask, it is permanent till the end of the whole procedure, and they are not supposed to touch the mask. So there is no need to change the mask during all any procedure or in between. Only thing I did, they advise us scrubbing and change of gown, gloves, whole thing, like how we do in general surgery between each patient. That is why you get the 15-20 minutes also. When the theater gets ready, this person gets ready. Or there is one more advice, if there are two people, they can alternatively operate between the gap. If there are two theaters, alternate theaters can be used. These were suggestions that came out in the meeting.
Oh, good, good, sir. You want to read some
questions? There are a few questions. I'll just consolidate them. These are specifically to do with the pre-op testing before surgery, sir. So what are all the tests that you would do for any generic case? Are there any specific ones? I think for GA, you had mentioned that the X-ray kind of things would be asked for. And also, they have asked, how would we deal with this kind of a requirement when we are dealing with free patients who need sometimes. Another question related to this is, what kind of generally, I think something related to this, what kind of elective surgeries eye hospitals should go ahead with? Should they do their routine all surgeries, or would you ask them to restrict it?
Madam, you want to answer? Shall I answer?
No, you go ahead, sir. Go ahead.
Okay, there are two, three things about eye surgery. GA only if it is a must, maybe a pediatric patient or somebody who will not be cooperating. Now we categorize now these patients into three categories. The green, the low risk, moderate risk and high risk. Low risk cataract, phaco will come under low risk. Moderate risk is where there could be some other bleeding or something. And the high risk could be a COVID positive patient or where there is a lot of aerosol generation processes. So for low and moderate, there is no problem. Everything is same. For high risk, if you are operating, you have to take complete precautions. Now the tests are, they have first initially, IJO was said you have to do X-ray test and so on and so on. Now X-ray test is not mandatory because many of the standalone eye hospitals will not have an X-ray unit. But if you think it's a patient with comorbidities, When these patients, if you think they need to get comorbidities like any lung problem or cardiac problem, you get a fitness. Then a standby anesthetist or a physician should be there, because it has been seen that some of the COVID positive patients without any symptom can come get admitted for a breathlessness, and within an hour or two, they lose their life also. So we should be prepared during surgery for these patients, so that no extra tests at all. They are not mandating this CBC and x-ray test and all those things. Definitely, if you suspect anything or if there is history, then you can advise. Otherwise, for GA cases, as your anesthetist wants, those tests should be done. Only thing, on the day of surgery, not to do any procedure, you know, which will be contact, and everything should be done earlier on, and the scheduling should be done so that they'll come, get operated, stay for the shortest period of time in the hospital and go. Okay, Mary?
Just to add to that, sir, this because now I agree with you, the chest x-ray, hemogram and all is really not needed. But what we have decided is, at least for the month of May, for the next 2 weeks, 3 weeks, we are going to do it. And in June, we'll again take a call.
Yeah,
so
sure,
since, as I was mentioning, and as our doctors here also felt, in view of not doing anything else, so that is the logic of doing these tests. But definitely, and we are going to re-look into all this in another few weeks.
No, I'm talking what AI was discussed today, that is all. If you have the facility, good. There is one more possibility, is when they go to these centers where they do imaging, they have found that many people are there without any kind of physical distancing, and waiting period is a long time because the number of facilities available. So that was also one issue that can come up, madam. Okay, madam.
Yeah, that's true. Okay.
There's one question about the mask the patient should be asked to wear, because now we're asking the patient to wear the mask while they lay on the table. Should they wear N95 or simply a three-layer cloth mask is enough?
As far as patients and attenders, there is no role for three-ply N95 or respirator at all. So they are now, in many places, the mask is compulsory even when they go on road. If they don't, when at the entry point, a mask should be given to them, whatever way. But one particular thing is, when they enter the theater, they should be given a three-ply surgical mask in the theater. The mask they have been wearing outside should not be allowed into the theater. So the theater should give them a three-ply mask on the inside the theater, and they have to wear it during surgery.
Okay, thank you, sir.
So the drapes, 1 minute, ma'am. The drapes which we put, no, for operating, they have adhesives. Most of the time between the nose and below, it will never get struck. So everybody should take care so that the adhesive is struck nicely, so that whatever they breathe will not come through that if there are droplets. So the adhesive between the nose, you know, and the inferior part of the eye, that will intralid, that is very important. It has to be pasted properly. Anything, madam?
I think that answers the question for the from the patient's side. So there's another question on the air conditioning. So what protocols for a non-modular OT or theaters with or without air conditioning, or a dehumidifier setting, air purifier with HEPA filters? So is any of these options for a non-modular OT?
Can I take the question totally and answer, madam?
Yes,
there are three possibilities. First, I would like to tell something, that American guidelines, ASHRAE gave guidelines, all this negative pressure for COVID wards and places where the COVID patients, so that this air is being sucked out of the area. That was the basic idea, and that has been modified by the Indian counterpart, ISHRAE. They have mentioned only specifically for COVID-19 patients. Now, what we are trying to do is, I put it for the theater. But we have to understand one thing, negative pressure may decompensate whatever you are trying to do for preventing endophthalmitis. So at this point in time, the advice is, do not do any major modifications for the existing theater. If you have to put dehumidified second aspirate AC or another filter, there is even ultra filter called 0.1 micron. Nothing is going to be sure, because we do not have any published reports. Right now, as madam said, better to wait for some time. Air handling, best done is by, you can do two things. You can increase the number of air exchanges. instead of three, even higher exchanges will make sure the hair goes out and increase the flow. So what will happen is, if you do anything, suddenly after 2 weeks, like, you know, we started CDC, no masks, then masks, then N95, then whole everybody wear masks. So it will change. So just bother about the cleaning protocols, disinfection protocols, and in between whatever we have to do, that is the maximum we can do, properly documented. But changing the air, we may land up in a trouble because there are no studies. There are no studies for theater. But HEPA filter is a totally positive pressure ventilation. If you want to make it negative, you have to put a lot of things, and the air going out has to be treated. So that is the advice, what they have decided in AOS today also.
Okay, so that's a very good point. Because that's, as I was mentioning, that's a lot of confusion in everybody's mind about air conditioning.
Yes.
So then after that,
quite a few people have asked about, is there anything specific that we need to keep in mind for LASIK procedures?
Madam, actually LASIK protocols I have not seen. There is a separate team they are developing, but that is a little different procedure because rehydration, everything occurs. I'm not sure about, they have not started LASIK anywhere. Only a few hospitals have started elective surgeries across the country. Few, they go by small numbers, 1, 2 and like that. LASIK, I am not really sure, madam.
Yes, as Dr. Chandrasekhar was mentioning, I think AOS is going to come up with guidelines in the next 1 week. So I think it is better to wait for the next 1 week till the 18th, then LASIK guidelines are going to come up. Then it'll be better if we follow that.
So they change that for every surgery.
Okay, you ask.
So the FMS, they meant the cassettes, the fluid management. So the question a couple of people have asked is to change the this cassette for cassette after every phaco surgery.
Okay. And today in the cataract phaco, they discussed about it. Many of them are using the same cassette for many cases. So if you have to change the cassette, there are a lot of problems they're facing. Actually, they have not finalized on the what to do about the cassettes. We are still awaiting the draft. So because the fluid goes in and comes and so many things are there, actually we don't have definitive, because the elective surgeries and phaco are yet to start. So actually there are no strict guidelines or published, but they are doing phaco without any problem. Cassettes I may not be able to answer, maybe in 2 or 3 days the guidelines will come. But the tip and the sleeve has to be definitely new one for every case. There is one more advice they say, you're going to open a set. Ideally, you know, we all assume this is, all the preparation is to prevent the employees from getting exposed. As far as the patient, we are bothered about end off and we are doing well. So you drape the patient and open the set so that doesn't contaminate it. Then take off the set and then undrape the patient. This is what some advice was given. And it sounds reasonable also. Because you have time now. We are not doing many cases. So it can all done as per protocol.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. I think there are other questions like, can Avastin injection be started? So the protocol for Avastin injection is, nothing has changed and there is no specific guidelines for that. The basic principle, as I mentioned in my first talk, is the social distancing. So as minimum as possible, people are inside the Avastin injection room, can easily be given. So we are doing it here routinely. Numbers are much, much low. And even in the waiting room, the attenders all are not allowed, just one patient alone. So that can be continued with no extra protocols needed for that.
So this one question is, if a patient becomes COVID positive after being operated at our hospital, what is the legal liability because we are not doing this COVID testing?
Very good. Sequelae. So the basic things we need to do for any patient, for that matter, including the employees, when they enter only, we should get this COVID-19 form. It's a separate form. We say this COVID-19 is there and the standard form given by AO is also. So that is, say, will clearly state that there is a possibility. Number one, if you're taking up for surgical patient, now a new consent form is going to come where this is also incorporated in the surgical form. we will not be liable whether it is an employee or a patient. But one thing we need to do properly is we should have a list of all the patients we see on a daily basis, the attenders accompanying them, their history forms which we take and keep and keep, and then say what they were, what where all they've got exposed in the hospital. And of course, this Arogya Setu, they have advised, if they get registered there, it will be good. This is because after 2 weeks, he gets COVID-19, they'll come back to our hospital to see, it may become a contact tracing. That is the only thing. Legally, as of now, we need to get the undertaking now. And that is the best thing to do. And we nobody can blame, because government has also given instruction, but always a written consent taken in whatever language they would understand would be a best idea to protect ourselves in the long run.
Thank you, sir. There are a lot of questions very specific to, can we do pediatric squint surgery? Can we do DC oculoplastic surgeries? So for all, the answer for all this is, if it is not an emergency right now, at least for the next 2 weeks or 3 weeks, it's best to refer them at least up to June. So unless if it is a very severe, the DCRU has to be done as an emergency. If not, my, at least our institute's thinking is at least wait up to June. So do you have any these things on that? Everybody's asking, even elective cataract surgeries also, when can we start doing, and all the other surgeries?
Actually, it is varying from place to place. Some states, they have told no elective surgeries definitively by the government. In some states, they have not mentioned anything about elective surgery. When the third, we had the lockdown started. That's all. But as of now, emergencies can be undertaken, and elective surgeries will be depending on the rule of the land. State law mainly, not the government of India has not given any directions, because some states have started, as I can see from various presentations. But you have to assume everybody is COVID, suspicious for COVID, and go ahead.
There are a few questions about, one is, do we need to keep the patient longer than usual, or is there any change in the way we recommend the post-operative follow-up visits?
Can I take that, or are you answering, madam?
Any difference in...
No, you answer, sir.
Yeah. The shortest period the patient is there in the hospital will be the best. For example, even scheduling, give by the hour. Don't come, ask the patient to come at 8 o'clock for a 12 o'clock surgery. 1 hour preparation only before the surgery. And as early as possible, they should be discharged, followed by complete room cleaning protocol. That is the rule. Discharge at the discretion of each institution, how you would like to see. At this point, they even advise teleconsultation, but within brackets, you have to say, you have to be very careful. Any suspicious symptom or sign, whatever they say, you should be careful, and you should not miss out on a complication which can be blinding. So that is a big question mark about teleconsultations. But you can decide on the time frame, because we know people after discharge, they come after 4 weeks also directly for if there is no problem. So, but this has to be, counseling is most important before surgery. They have to talk about COVID-19 and what is the problem. They must be explained about the PPE, how to use them, how to take them, how to not to touch them. And the third one would be how they will be not touching unnecessary surfaces. Fourth one would be how they'll maintain distancing, unnecessarily grouping together and talking, and about the attender. So this is also important. And once they go back also, you have to give all the explanations, because they're going into the house from the hospital.
Okay, thank you. So there's one last one I think we'll take, since it's been asked two or three times about the material of the gown of the surgeon. So since now it's a cloth gown, the questions are, since it's a cloth gown, they would all absorb all these splashes which happen. So what kind of gowns can we wear, and what material is recommended?
Okay, what they have decided, two things, madam. The hospitals, government hospitals, say they may not be able to get a disposable gown. So the linen gown, they have advice. But they can get two gowns, one impermeable gown and the linen gown, some of them have advised. Ideally, the impermeable disposable is ideal. They have got specifications regarding the thickness so that it will not percolate.
Okay, thank you. I think we have just one more minute, sir. So would you like to have a quick summary? of this whole webinar?
Yes, dear friends, I know every eye hospital, they want to start off theater because it is going to make the livelihood of many, many people. We can start, but we have to be very cautious. Universal or standard precautions, not all patients, all people, personnel, attender, employee, and the patient, all of them should be treated as alike. You take universal precautions, everybody in the hospital should take universal precautions. As easy it is for corona to spread, it is easy for us to disinfect. Only thing, you have to disinfect. So take it, but you have to be cautious, and you keep on educating. Giving on mask to security and telling to wear without telling how to wear is no good. So education will play a major role, and we have to be very cautious. Time and again, you keep following. There will be newer guidelines which will get updated. It is going to go on for quite some time, but you have to be very cautious about data, because the time spent by the patient is long time, long communication, long contact, more the exposure, more viral load, more complications, and more infectious. Definitely all of you will do well. Stay safe. Thank you very much for the opportunity, madam, and like, thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. So with one last word is, agree with everything what Chandrasekhar said, but there is no need to panic also. So that is also should be reassured to the staff. Every day, in fact, you can have a reassurance that everything has been taken care of and there's no need to panic. And we are not at any more increased risk than anybody else. Thank you.
Thank you, all of you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much, madam. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you. The recording of this presentation will be uploading on YouTube. Thank you, everyone, for your patient listening and for the questions. Thank you. We'll close this webinar.